Mr. Gruby kept his eyes down. The tractor and reaper below, negotiating the bottom right corner of the narrow, steep triangle of wheat, bumbled and nagged and stopped and started. The sweat trickled at the corner of his eye. Not a breath of air moved to relieve him. A dull atmosphere of pain had settled just above eye level, and he had the impression that the whole top of heaven had begun to glare and flame. For nearly 3 hours, since 9 that morning, not the faintest gossamer of cloud had intervened between the sun and the thin felt of his trilby. A sunbather would have escaped a cover an hour ago. 10 more minutes would finish the field. The best sport of all, he knew, usually comes in the last 10 minutes. He would be a fool to go off and miss that after waiting for it, earning it, so to speak, all morning. Laying his gun over a prone sheaf, he stripped off his waistcoat and draped that beside the gun, then raised his trilby and mopped the bald dome under it with his handkerchief, taking a few steps out and back again to bring the air to some coolness against his brow. This was surely unnatural heat. He could remember nothing like it. The hanging dust, raised by the tractor and the hurrying blade of the cutter, absorbed the sun's vibrations till it seemed hot as only a solid substance ought to be. And the spluttering reports, the dense machine gun bursts from the tractor as it started up the gradient, tore holes in the blanketing air with something even fiery and deadlier. Near the edge of the field, the dark, scorched-looking figures of out-of-work or off-work colliers, gathering the sheaves into stokes, with their black or tan whippets bouncing around them, and one big, white, bony greyhound appeared hellish, as if they flitted to and fro in not quite visible flames. This was Gruby's first day out in the open since the previous summer. He had intended to stay out for only a couple of hours, expecting the field to be finished by 11. 2 hours today, 4 or 5 tomorrow, and so on, acclimatizing himself gradually, till he could take a whole day and enjoy the whole harvest. Perhaps 3 hours was a bit too much to begin with. Perhaps he was overdoing it. 10 more minutes then, and he would leave. 10 more minutes, and after that, no matter how little of the field was left to cut, he would leave. He didn't want to spoil his holiday at the start. By standing perfectly still, leaving his body to the sun's rays, and shrinking inwardly from all its surfaces, he found he could defy both the slowness of time and the huge enveloping weight of the heat. He crouched in a tiny darkness somewhere near the bottom of his spine, and dreamed of his car in the stone barn half a mile behind him across the fields. He smelt the cool leather of the upholstery, and the fresh, thickly daubed mustard and beef sandwiches lying there with 2 bottles of beer under the rug on the back seat. The tractor came up to make its looping turn at the top corner. As Gruby stepped back, the grizzled chimpanzee figure at the wheel shouted something to him and jabbed a finger down toward the wheat, and the long, dark brown creature perched above the cutter shouted and pointed at the wheat, while the shuddering combination slewed around on itself, suddenly disgorging its roar over Gruby as if a door had opened. Then the blades swept in again, wheat ears raining down under the red paddles of the reaper, every few feet a new sheaf leaping out under the stubble. So many activities, so much hot, busy iron in a wake of red dust, drawing off, leaving Gruby isolated and surprisingly whole, as if he too had been tossed out like one of the sheaves. Roused, he stepped up close and resumed his watch down the 2 diverging walls of stalks. The shouts of the farmer and his man meant they had seen something in the patch. Whatever remained in there would be whisking from side to side, like fish trapped in shallowing water, as the reaper closed in. Gruby held his gun in the crook of his left arm, like a baby, fondling the chased side plates and trigger guard, and mentally rehearsing for the 100th time the easy swing, overtaking the running shape with a smooth squeeze on the trigger and follow through, one gliding, effortless motion, like a gesture in conversation. 50 yards behind him, 2 dead rabbits lay under a sheaf. He had missed 3. His shooting was not good. But he loved the occasion, or rather, he had looked forward to it, remembering the days last summer when rabbits had been flying out in all directions, getting themselves snagged in the cutter, or bowled over by the collier's sticks, or rolled in a flurry of dust by the dogs, and he himself shooting to right and left like a hero at a last stand. That was the sport, banging away. But last summer there had been no such heat. He wondered if the farmer thought it unusual. Maybe it was a record heat wave, following the freakish dispersal during the night of some protective layer in the upper atmosphere. The Sunday papers would be full of it, with charts and historical comparisons. Or maybe he was simply growing old, beginning to fail in the trials. He imagined there must be certain little tests that showed the process clearly. A day of rain, the first snow, or, as now, a few hours in the sun. Were these to become terrors? And he had put on a few pounds since last summer. The trilby was a mistake. His brain felt black and numb and solid like a hot stone. Tomorrow he would bring a broad-brimmed Panama hat. The Stukas would snigger, no doubt, but they knotted handkerchiefs over their heads like little boys. He watched the tractor turning again at the bottom of the strip, and it was now, as the tractor started up the slope towards him, that a strange sensation came over Groovy. Whether at the idea of all the energy needed and being exerted to drag such a weight of vibrating iron up that hill in that heat, or at the realization that here was help approaching, and he could therefore allow himself to yield a little to the sun, he suddenly lost control of his limbs and felt himself floating in air a few feet above the crushed stubble. He sat down hastily, adjusting his pose to look as natural as possible, but nevertheless alarmed and with a deep conviction that he was too late. He had closed his eyes and heard a voice in the darkness announcing over and over in brisk, businesslike tones that he would now leave the field immediately. The sun had gathered to a small red spot in the top of his brain. He thought with terror of the distance back to the farm and safety. The short walk seemed to writhe and twist like a filament over a gulf of fire. Opening his eyes, he found the tractor's headplate as it climbed towards him, centering his vision. And like a drunken man, he anchored his attention to that, as if it were the last spark of consciousness. Slowly, his head cleared. He changed his position. And now, as the world reassembled, he became aware that the farmer was standing erect in the tractor, waving his free arm and shouting. Groovy looked round for some explanation. The Stukas had stopped work and were looking towards him, straining towards him almost like leashed dogs, while the dogs themselves craned round, quivering with anxiety, tucking their tails in for shame at seeing nothing, but they knew there was something, eager to see something and be off. Groovy took all this in remotely, as through the grill of a visor. He had a dim notion that they were all warning him back from the brink of something terrible. Then his eyes focused. A yard out from the wall of wheat, 10 yards from Groovy, and directly in the path of the tractor, a large hare sat erect. It stared fixedly, as if it had noted some suspicious detail in the far distance. Actually, it was stupefied by this sudden revelation of surrounding enemies. Driven all morning from one side of the shrinking wheat to the other, terrified and exhausted by the repeated roaring charge and nearer miss of the tractor in its revolutions, the hare's nerves had finally cracked, and here it was in the open, trying to recognize the strangely shorn hillside, confronted by the shapes of men and dogs, with a tractor coming up again to the left and a man scrambling to his feet on the skyline above to the right. So it sat up, completely nonplussed. Groovy aimed mercilessly. But then he perceived that the farmer's shouts had redoubled and altered in tone, and the farmhand on the cutter had joined the shouting, flourishing his arms with violent pushing movements away to his left, as if Groovy's gun muzzles were advancing on his very chest. Accordingly, Groovy realized that the tractor, too, lay above his gun barrels. He held his aim for a moment, not wanting to forgo his prior claim on the hare, and glanced over toward the dogs, flustered and angry. But for those dogs, the hare would surely have run straight out, giving a clean, handsome shot. Now, any moment, The dogs would come clowning across the field, turn the hare back into the wheat, and hunt it right through and away out at the bottom into the uncut field of rye down there, around the back of the hill into the other fields. To anticipate the dogs, Gruby started to run to the left, down the other side of the wheat, thinking to bring the hare against open background. But before he had gone 3 strides, the hare was off, an uncertain, high-eared, lolloping gait, still unable to decide the safe course or the right speed, till the dogs came ripping long, smoldering tracks up the field, and Gruby fired. He forgot all about swing and squeeze and follow-through. He was enraged, off balance, distracted by the speeding dogs, and at all times hated shots from left to right. But his target loomed huge, close and moving slowly. The gun jarred back on his shoulder. The hare somersaulted, as if tossed into the air by the hind legs, came down in a flash of dust and streaked back into the wheat. For a second, Gruby thought he must have fainted. He could hear the farmer yelling to the colliers to call their dogs off, threatening to shoot the bloody lot, but the voice came weirdly magnified and distorted, as if his hearing had lost its muting defenses. His head spun in darkness. He knew he'd fallen. He could hear the tractor protesting on the gradient, and it seemed so near, the engine drove so cruelly into his ears, he wondered if he had fallen in front of it. The ground trembled beneath him. Surely they would see him lying there. His senses cleared a little. And as at the moment of waking from nightmare to the pillow and the familiar room, Gruby realized he was lying face downward in the wheat. He must have fainted and staggered into the wheat and fallen there. But why hadn't they noticed him? Twisting his head, he saw what he could scarcely believe, the red paddling flails of the reaper coming up over him. Within seconds, those terrible hidden ground-shaving blades would melt the stalks and touch him. He would be sawn clean in two. He had seen them slice rabbits like bacon. He uttered a cry to whoever might hear and rolled sideways, dragging himself on his elbows, tearing up the wheat in his hands as he clawed his way out of the path of the mutilator, and cried again, this time in surprise, as a broad wrench of pain seemed to twist off the lower half of his body, so that for a moment he thought the blades had caught him. With a final convulsion, he threw himself forward and sprawled parallel to the course of the tractor. This is how it happens, his brain was yammering. It can happen, and it's happened. This is how it happens. Everything is going nicely, then one careless touch, one wink of a distraction, and your whole body's in the mincer, and you're in the middle of it, the worst that can happen forever. You've never dreamed it possible, and all your life it's been this fraction of a second away, an inch from you, and here it is, here it is. The noise of the tractor and the special grinding clatter of the cutter seemed to come up out of the raw soil, taking possession of all the separate atoms of his body. The tractor's outline rose black against the blue sky, and Gruby saw the farmer standing at the wheel, looking down. He cried out and waved an arm like a drowning man, whereupon the farmer pointed at him, shouting something. Then the flails came over, and he heard the blades withering in the air. For a second, everything disintegrated in dim, chaffy fragments and dust. Then they had gone past, and Gruby lay panting. Why hadn't they stopped? They saw him and went straight past. The end of the cutter bar had gone by inches from his face, and now he could see through the thin veil of stalks and out over the naked stubble slope. Why hadn't they stopped and got down to help him? He gathered himself and once more tried to get to his feet, but the baked clods of soil and the bright metallic stalks of wheat fled into a remote, silent picture as the pain swept up his back again and engulfed him. But only for a moment, he jerked up his head. Hands held his shoulders, and someone splashed his face with water that ran down his neck and over his chest. He shook himself free and stood. As if he had tripped only accidentally, he began to beat the dust from his trousers and elbows, ignoring the ring of men who had come up and stood in a circle watching. All the time, he was trying to recall exactly what happened. He remembered, as if touching a forgotten dream, that he'd been lying in the wheat. Had they carried him out then? He flexed his back cautiously, but that felt easy, with no trace of discomfort. The farmer handed him his trilby. All right now? He nodded. Gun must have caught me off balance. Only explanation. Knocked me clean out. He adopted his brusquest managerial air, putting the farmer and this gang of impudent anonymous colliers' faces back into place. What had they seen, he wondered. They could tell him, but how could he possibly ask? One of those flukes, he added. The farmer was watching him thoughtfully, as if expecting him to fall again. Well, what happened to the hare? Gruby demanded. His continued gusty assurance took effect. Whatever they had seen or were suspecting, they had to take account of this voice. The farmer nodded in his ancient, withered-up way. You're all right, then. He turned on the Stukas in surprising fury. What the hell am I paying you for? As they all trooped off down the field with their sullen dogs, the farmer started the tractor up and the cutter blade blurred into life. Left alone, Gruby sank into a shocked stupor. His mind whirled around like a fly that dared not alight. The black vacancy held him. Something important was going on, if only he could grasp it. He seemed unable to move, even to wipe away the sweat that collected in his eyebrows and leaked down into his eyes. It occurred to him that the sun had settled over the earth, so that the air was actually burning gas, depth of flame in every direction. He watched the tractor dwindle in the bottom of the field, as if it were melting into a glittering puddle in the haze. How could men go on working in that temperature? The Stukas were clearly charring. They were black as burnt twigs, tiny black ant men moving on the gray field. One cut up and one down would finish the piece. And this prospect partly revived Gruby, including him once more in events. As the tractor waded up one side, now only 15 yards or so long, he walked down the other, scrutinizing the thin curtain of stalks where every clump of weed had ears and seemed to be sitting up alert. At the bottom, a few paces back into the stubble, Gruby took up his position for the final sweep. Now the hare must either show itself or be killed by the cutter, unless it had already died in there of that first shot. As the tractor bore down, the colliers left their work, edging forward till Gruby noticed they had moved up level with him, as if to supervise the kill. He advanced a little, separating himself. The thought that the hare's first appearance would bring two or three dogs dancing across the line of fire unnerved him. Also, he didn't want these men to be looking at his face, which felt to be ludicrously pink and sweating its very fat. If only the tractor would hurry up and get it over, or if only the hare would gather its wits and move. But the tractor seemed to have stopped. Gruby blinked and straightened himself vigorously, and that brought the tractor on a little more quickly. From the lowest corner of the wheat, the few stalks that would be last to fall leaned out and tormented him in those endless seconds. Then all at once, here was the hare, huge as if nothing else existed. The colliers shouted and the gun jumped to Gruby's shoulder. But he held his fire. The animal was too near. He saw the roughness of its brindled, gingery flanks and the delicate lines of its thin face. Besides, it seemed to want to surrender and was so obviously bewildered that for a moment Gruby felt more like shooing it away to safety than shooting it dead. But it had already realized its folly, and swerving sharply to Gruby's right, launched itself up the hill like a dart, a foot above the ground, while the farmer stood shouting in the tractor as those last stalks fell, and the dogs behind Gruby climbed the air, yelling and coughing on their restrained collars. He had bare seconds, he knew, before the dogs broke loose all around him, and it was with half his attention behind him that Gruby fired at 10 yards range. The hare flattened in a scatter of dust, but was on its feet again, flogging its way up the slope, more heavily now, its hindquarters collapsing every few strides. It looked just about finished, and rather than spoil it with a choke barrel or miss it clean, and also in order to be ahead of those dogs whatever happened, Gruby set off at a lumbering run. Immediately the hare picked up and stretched away ahead. Gruby stopped and aimed. The sweat flooded his eyes, and he felt he ought to sit. He heard the shouting, and wiping his eyes and brow with one fierce movement along his left arm, brought his cheek back to the gun as one of the whippets ripped past him like a lit trail of gunpowder. He aimed furiously toward the bouncing shape of the hare and fired. The blackness struck him. The wild realization that he had done it again, the blasted gun had hit him again, was swallowed up. He seemed to have fallen forward and thought he must have gone head over heels. One need possessed him. It drove him to struggle up the hill. None of his limbs belonged to him anymore, and he wondered if he still lay in the wheat and whether the cutter blades had indeed gone over him. But loudest of all, he heard the dogs. The dogs were behind him with their inane yapping. He began to shout at them, and shouted louder than ever when he heard the sound that twisted from his throat, the unearthly thin scream. Then the enormous white dog's head opened beside him, and he felt as if he had been picked up and flung, and lost awareness of everything, save the vague pummeling sensations, far off in the blankness and silence of his body.